In part 12, we looked at how some use Philippians 2, 5 through 8 to contradict their own teachings that Christ never claimed his equality with God, while at the same time offering up proof that Christ claimed to be equal with God by pointing to how the scribes and Pharisees tried to stone Christ for doing just that. Notice, too, they rarely ever quote the next few verses of Philippians 2.
Wherefore God also hath highly exalted him, and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven, and things in earth, and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father.
For the Trinitarian, these are the most problematic verses in the entire body of Scripture. Why so? Because Trinity teaches that Christ is co-eternal with God the Father. He exists co-equally and co-eternally with God and as God. He therefore would not need to be rewarded for his obedience by being highly exalted. His exaltation would be a given. The moment he left his fleshly existence and returned to the heavenly realm, he would return to his co-equal status with the Almighty. The author of Philippians would simply be wrong in his assertion that because Christ humbled himself as a servant and was obedient to the cross, therefore God highly exalted him. Neither his obedience while he's on the earth nor his death would have any bearing whatsoever on his being highly exalted. Again, it says because of his obedience to the death, he was given a name above every other name. Being that he is co-equal and co-eternal with the Father, that name would already be his the moment he left his fleshly estate. Granted, they say that he left behind that name and title when he came to the earth, yet it would not matter what manner of death he suffered. The moment he left the flesh behind, he would return to his former state of co-equality with God Almighty. He would not need to be given a name above all names as a reward for his obedience while on the earth. This name would be his entitlement. He exists as God for all eternity according to Trinity and modalism. Yet the statement that he was rewarded with exaltation and the highest name because he was obedient is problematic for the modalist as well. For to whom was Christ being obedient? To himself? How does this merit a reward? He's merely doing his own will, as most sane creatures do. When he states, "I only do the will of my Father who sent me," he'd be lying, for in fact, he's doing his own will, for he sent himself to begin with. Certainly, it was God's will that Christ die on the cross, for it's God's will that each creature have his own free will, including those hell-bent on murdering God's own Son. Christ did have a moment of weakness in the garden just before they took him, and this has a simple explanation. He was a man, and men have moments of weakness. To take this truth and turn it so that you have God wanting Christ to be brutally murdered from the very beginning of time itself, so that God's bloodlust could be sated, is just sickening. I myself once erroneously took John 3:16 out of context and made it a statement that God gave his Son as a sacrifice. I was taught to do this. However, when we examine the context of that chapter, it becomes obvious that what Christ was referring to was his resurrection and the outpouring of the Parakletos to make men born of the Spirit.
Jesus answered and said unto him, "Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God."
Our new birth in the Spirit comes not just by his death, but by his resurrection.
"Know ye not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death? Therefore we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection, knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. For he that is dead is freed from sin.
So the subject of John 3 is the purpose of the resurrection more than the purpose of Christ's life on this earth and his death. Another scripture many often read wrong is,
and as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up.
According to many, the above verse is a reference to Christ being lifted up on a cross, just as the snake was lifted up on a pike. They turn the death of Christ into the healing power spoken of in the text. All who look upon the dead Christ on the cross, they say, will be healed. If this were so, then Paul was in grave error, saying that if Christ is not risen from the dead, you are yet in your sins.
And if Christ be not raised, your faith is vain, ye are yet in your sins.
If it is the belief in Christ's death, if it is the vision of Christ lifted up on a cross that saves us and frees us from sin, then Paul would be wrong. All you would need is faith in his death, and you would no longer be in your sins. Yet Paul was not wrong, for our faith is that God rose him from the dead. That is where our faith lies, and why, if he did not rise, our faith would be in vain. Christ, in talking about the serpent on the pike, is talking about his resurrection. The serpent does not represent Christ on the cross. The serpent represents Satan, defeated by the death and resurrection of Christ. The serpent has always been the devil in Scripture. From Genesis to Revelation, the serpent represents Satan, not Christ. Christ would not compare himself to the serpent on a pike. He's clearly talking about the fulfillment of the prophecy God made to Eve when he said she would crush the serpent's head. Christ defeated Satan not just on the cross, but in his resurrection. In fact, it is by his resurrection that he sends the Paracletos, and it is by the power of God through his anointing that the believers destroy the works of the devil in their lives. So Christ was not a gift because of his death alone, but because of the ultimate resurrection and his being exalted to the right hand of the Father, where he could be our advocate and where he could send the anointing, the Paracletos, the Comforter. All we have to do to put John 3:14 and John 3:16 into their context again is to read the entire text. Just read the verse before, John 3:13.
And no man hath ascended up to heaven, but he that came down from heaven, even the Son of Man which is in heaven.
Clearly, Scripture is speaking of his resurrection here, and of his ascension unto the Father following his resurrection, and the ultimate conversation is our being born again of the Spirit. Read what he says after John 3:14.
That whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have eternal life.
So Christ said that he was lifted up from the earth, rose and ascended to the Father, being highly exalted, so that whoever believes on him, on his resurrection and on his exaltation, should have eternal life. That is why Paul said, if you don't believe Christ is raised, your faith is in vain. Our faith is in the death and resurrection, not just the death. This false teaching that the death of Christ saves you, like a serpent hanging on a pole heals, renders the resurrection completely irrelevant. They preach we are saved by his death, but Paul and the apostles didn't preach that. They preached we were saved by his life, by his resurrection. That if you didn't believe in the resurrection, you were not saved. I hate to single out the Catholics, yet we must look at the reason the Catholics preach that Christ's death is what saves you. And the Protestants and evangelicals follow suit, preaching the same without realizing they are giving tacit approval to the Catholic teaching of Eucharist, something they claim to despise. For it is because of the Holy Eucharist that salvation by the death of Christ was so important early on. The claim that Christ died for one purpose, the transubstantiation, whereby their priests bless the wine and the bread, and they literally become the body and the blood of Jesus, which the priest then administers. This is what brings salvation according to the Catholic Church, and conveniently, they are the only ones that can administer it, so you must be a Catholic to be saved. This is the significance of the blood of Jesus to the Catholic. It's why they preach salvation by the death of Christ. They have replaced the Parakletos and the born-again experience, which came only by the resurrection and is administered by one person, even Christ himself, with eating a wafer and drinking some wine, administered only by a Catholic priest in a magical rite. It is the resurrection and death upon which our faith stands and is our salvation, not just the death of Christ.
That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more, being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life.
It is not the atoning sacrifice of Christ, nor the reconciliation back unto God alone that saves you, but it is those things along with Christ's resurrection. It is his resurrection, his being lifted up and ascending to the right hand of the Father, and thus being able to send the Parakletos. We are not born again by his death alone, but by his death and his life, resurrection. Let us get back to Abraham's near sacrifice of Isaac on the altar and then see how this all relates. If the attempted sacrifice of Isaac on an altar were to be a figure of Christ, then Isaac would have had to die on the altar. Isaac did not die. The sacrifice was interrupted. For that matter, why didn't God just let Abraham go through with the sacrifice? If all that was needed for the salvation of all mankind was a human sacrifice and the shedding of innocent human blood for the sins of all men, why not have Abraham just sacrifice his son for this purpose? Isaac would have instantly been the seed of promise and would have accomplished salvation for all mankind. Certainly, Isaac, being young, was not yet at the age of accountability. Where there is no law, sin is not imputed.
For until the law, sin was in the world, but sin is not imputed when there is no law.
So Isaac was innocent blood, and if all that was required was innocent blood shed for all of man's sins, then why not just have Abraham go through with the sacrifice and make Isaac the savior of all mankind? I'll go one better. Even if you believe that children are born sinners, we know that sin is not imputed where there is no law. Therefore, why didn't God just replace the sacrifice of goats and rams with the sacrifice of human babies who would shed innocent blood for the forgiveness of all mankind's sins? The fact that the sacrifice of Isaac was stopped before it could be completed is all the proof we need that God does not do human sacrifice. Many teach that the death of Isaac on an altar could not have saved us, that it had to be God incarnate who died on the altar of sacrifice. Notice they don't have a single scripture to back this teaching up. It is also logical fallacy. Why would God have to come down to the earth and himself shed his own innocent blood in order to grant himself the permission to forgive and overlook the sins of mankind? Especially since God had been forgiving and overlooking all the sins of every man who ever lived from Adam unto Christ. They teach that mankind needed blanket forgiveness for all sins past, present, and future. They needed God to just say, "Forget about sin. Now that I have died for you myself, sin is no longer relevant." Yet they deny preaching license to sin. God could have just had Abraham sacrifice the innocent blood of Isaac for the sins of all mankind, and then raised Isaac from the dead as he did with Christ. Yet the apostles did say that Abraham's near sacrifice of Isaac has significance to we, the believers, but not for the reasons they claim.
By faith Abraham, when he was tried, offered up Isaac, and he that had received the promises offered up his only begotten son, of whom it was said, that in Isaac shall thy seed be called, accounting that God was able to raise him up, even from the dead, from whence also he received him in a figure.
The figure here is not that Abraham is like God, sacrificing his own son on an altar, but rather that Abraham had faith in the resurrection. Abraham knew that Isaac was the promised seed, and therefore the author of Hebrews claims, Abraham believed that if he slew Isaac on the altar, that God would raise him up again. The figure is Abraham's belief in a resurrection, which would be irrelevant if Christ is merely a warm body to be sacrificed on an altar for atonement. All that would be necessary for the salvation is the death of the warm body and the pouring out of the blood. Resurrection would not be required. Especially if Christ is God the Son, or God Himself, and has merely, after His death, returned to His former glorious state in the heavenlies. Why would God bother to resurrect the body of Christ at all? Certainly that resurrection would have no real significance to those who come to the death and to the shedding of blood for their salvation.